I'd like to recognize some of our guests seated at our head table. We have Vice Admiral Richard from the USSTRATCOM, who will be speaking to you here shortly. Mayor Rita Sanders. Rick Sanders. And then Northrop Grumman. And I'd like to thank Russ. Russ and Artie had quite a trip coming in from Colorado, so appreciate you getting here. But he's also one of our presenting sponsors, so Russ, thank you. Rick Perry, also from Northrop Grumman. Rick. And then Colonel Berg with Offutt Air Force Base, the Wing Vice Commander. So thank you, guys. In the crowd today, too, I thought we'd point out that we have some of our other dignitaries with us. We have Pat Shannon from our city council. Pat. Dr. Jeff Rippey with Bellevue Public Schools. He's our superintendent, our new superintendent, too. So. Now I'm going to give the podium to our presenting sponsor, Russ Inardi from Northrop. Russ wants to come on up here.
Well, I know you came not to hear me, but to hear Admiral Richard, so I'll be very brief. It's my honor on behalf of over 300 colleagues, Northrop Grumman, that live and work in this community. It's my honor just to thank you for coming out and to thank you as a teammate for what you do day to day. You know, we especially appreciate the partnership with U.S. Strategic Command, with the host, the 55th Wing. We've been here through legacy companies since the 1960s. Very proud of the work that we have done over the years. So it's just great to be a part of this. Mayor Sanders, this is a wonderful community. It is a home to so many of our families. So thanks for what you do in the community. And again, thanks for being here.
Again, we want to thank Northrop Grumman for your support. And again, it wouldn't be possible without this type of support from our sponsors. I'd like to introduce our guest speaker today. Vice Admiral Charles Richards is a career submariner. You find it a little unusual here in Nebraska, but you can share your story about the airport here too. But he is currently the Deputy Commander of U.S. Strategic Command. His flag assignments include Director of Underseas Warfare Division, N-97, in Washington, D.C., Command of a Submarine Group, 10, in Kings Bay, Georgia, and the Deputy Commander of Joint Functional Component Command for Global Strike at U.S. Strategic Command. His operational assignments include Command of Submarine NR-1, USS Parche, did I get that? Parche or Parche? And the Submarine Squadron 17. Other significant staff assignments include Executive Assistant and Naval Aide to the Undersecretary of the Navy, Mr. Robert Work, Chief of Staff, Submarine Force Atlantic, and a member of the Chief of Naval Operations, Strategic Studies Group 28, studying the integration of unmanned systems into the naval forces. Now, I'll tell you that I think in your program, it's a much deeper bio than this. Extremely bright individual with quite the criteria. This is the short version of the bio, which is just unbelievable in itself. But Vice Admiral Richard, I appreciate you coming here out today, and I'm going to turn the podium over to you.
So. Jim, thank you so very much. So good afternoon, everybody, and thank you for inviting me over. It is terrific to be back in Bellevue. As noted earlier, this is my second time here. I was the deputy commander at the Global Strike Component underneath STRATCOM. Loved that tour, asked to come back, and was fortunate to get my request granted. Right, just love everything about Bellevue and Omaha and the base. Well, except maybe one thing, right? So I do have a southern background. And so the first time I got here, and I'm driving down General's Road trying to figure out exactly where my house is, and I noticed that all the fire hydrants have a 4-foot fiberglass pole on them. And I'm sort of asking myself, you know, why would a fire hydrant need a pole? And then one of y'all were kind enough to tell me, you know, so the snow plows don't hit it. And I'm like, oh no, but it is great to be back. And, you know, our mission to guarantee the United States security being performed every day inside the gates just down the street from us is one of the most weighty that I've had a privilege to be a part of. And I think that y'all should be proud of hosting that mission as well. And I think, or I understand it's been a while since you've heard from the STRATCOM command staff, and you know, it's been a total leadership change, starting with General Hyten relieving Admiral Haney here not too long ago. So first, on his behalf, from General Hyten and myself, thank you for being our host community, and thank you for welcoming us the way you do. I've been in a lot of bases, a lot of places over my 34 years in the military, and I would point to the relationship between Offutt and Bellevue as one of the shining examples of how this is done correctly. We're both very glad to be back. I'm here on his behalf this morning, right, to share you his vision for STRATCOM, to reiterate the importance of our nuclear and strategic deterrent missions, and to highlight how that new headquarters building that you see being constructed over there is going to support that. So General Hyten, as the commander responsible for the United States' security, one has reinstated the former Strategic Air Command motto, "Peace is our profession," across the command, and I applaud that. We keep that peace by maintaining a credible strategic deterrent. And you know, we do that in the forces assigned to STRATCOM every day. The most powerful forces in the U.S. military, and I'd offer the only ones that you don't have to pull the trigger on for it to do its mission. So when we say that we use the nuclear effect every day, that's what we're talking about, right? It is the mere potential of its use that causes people to think differently, and that is precisely what we're about. General Hyten's newly released vision and intent, three priorities, right? He has been able to take a very complex stack of missions and capabilities and distill them down into a crystal clear stack of things that he wants us to do. Number one, strategic deterrence. Second, delivering a decisive response should strategic deterrence fail. And then finally, maintaining a combat-ready force. As a global warfighting command, STRATCOM delivers strategic nuclear effects every single day by implementing those priorities. They're designed to ensure that we deter our adversaries from ever thinking the reward would outweigh the risk of an attack on the United States. Now, of course, our nation's nuclear deterrent is only as effective as the command and control networks that enable it to function. And I should pause there for a second. I did just come from the Pentagon, so I run this risk of sort of speaking in Pentagon speak. What we're talking about there is the communications capability, the circuits, the mechanisms that General Hyten uses to command his forces and know what they're doing, and ultimately for us to receive presidential direction and go off and execute it. And as a part of maintaining that into the future, it means a modern command and control facility for U.S. Strategic Command. So you see the building going up. It's going to support all of our missions, right, from the seafloor up through space, and is on track for occupancy here in late 2018. It'll serve as a visible reminder to our adversaries of our national commitment to maintain modern and effective nuclear command, control, and communications capabilities. It's going to be the worldwide headquarters for integrating our strategic forces across multiple domains at the command and commander responsible for the most powerful strategic assets this nation has ever produced. It requires a robust capability of interdependent systems, facilities, platforms. You're talking about doing operations in land, sea, air, space, cyberspace to effectively execute these operations and provide support to the president. Hey, it's a very complex effort, and I get that. In fact, I'm kind of responsible to the commander for making sure this thing comes together. So I did want to take a moment to address the article that came out last month in the Omaha World Herald that was highlighting some of the risks inherent at this stage of the construction. I mean, the bottom line is the building is very far along in terms of its construction, and at the risk of oversimplifying it a little bit, it's time to start wiring it up, right? We have to put all of these systems inside there. And so the local Army Corps of Engineers lead is correct in saying that there is an amazing number of systems to have to interact, right? And I think the term fraught with peril was used in the article, which was like, that seems kind of scary, right? Sort of has reminds you maybe of me trying to put together the grill this weekend on the garage driveway, and I got to get four screw C's, and where do those go, right? Rest assured that we have a tremendous number of professionals that are engaged in putting the building together and bringing those systems up. They're operating similar systems over in the LeMay building today. It's not like we don't have the people that designed it here. So we have tremendous talent, tremendous expertise in terms of accomplishing this piece of bringing that building and systems online. Plus, we have them all operating today in the LeMay building. So in the final analysis, until the new one is tested and ready to go, we just won't turn the old one off, right? So I have great confidence in the team led by the Navy Space and Naval Warfare Systems Command to do the right engineering, bring this thing together, and to bring that new building online well into the future. So, construction progress aside, that is a $1.2 billion investment that has been made to modernize our headquarters, and it also speaks to the longevity of Offutt Air Force Base. We're proud to perform our mission here, and the responsibility that STRATCOM has to counter the most consequential threats this nation faces. That's a tremendous responsibility, and I want y'all to know that I come to work every day with a great sense of urgency, right, in terms of what we need to do to defend this nation. Look, I can remember as a kid back in Alabama, it actually turns out the commander and I both are from Alabama and grew up about 15 miles from each other. But I do remember looking up in the sky occasionally at night and wondering if tonight was the night, right? Was this when the Soviet bombers were gonna show up, right? Were the Soviet missiles? I didn't do this often, but it did happen. I'm old enough to have done a duck and cover drill, right? That was in kindergarten, in elementary school, one in high school, right? Not that old. But I have literally done those. So let me ask y'all, who in here has done something like that? And for those of you that may be my age, think about your children or other family members that you know, right? I'll tell you, my kids have never, ever thought about something like that. It is not in their psyche that someone would actually consider a nuclear attack on the United States. And that is my point, right? That is what strategic deterrence looks like. You achieve that by having 4,000 strategic deterrent patrols. You achieve that with innumerable hours sitting in a missile silo or sorties in aircraft or standing watch in our global operations center. We have been so successful as Strategic Command at accomplishing our mission, we have just taken that out of the American psyche. And so the question becomes, how did that happen in my lifetime? How did we achieve that level of success? And I'd offer that for 70 years, strategic deterrence has enabled a world free of conflict between major powers. Look, this nation has been at war for 15 years, right? Terrible war with terrible sacrifice. But that is not the same thing as a major power conflict, World War II being the last example. And that is something that I worry that we don't understand and can't remember what violence on that scale looks like. In World War II, the planet had over 1 million casualties per month for 4.5 years. Thankfully, we have not seen violence on that scale ever since, and hopefully never will again. Why is that? Why did that stop in 1945? Well, some would argue, and I think with some merit, that's because we have improved cooperation between nations, right? We have figured out how to resolve our differences short of resorting to violence. I would argue that's true, but I would also argue that back in 1945, with the advent of nuclear weapons, the consequences of settling disputes by violence became intolerable, that we simply couldn't accept that and had to find other means to go about doing that. So let me give you a better way of saying it. General Robert Kaler, who many of you I think remember as a former commander here at STRATCOM, said this: while much has changed since the end of the Cold War, nuclear weapons continue to meet a critical need in U.S. security strategy and the strategy of our allies and partners. While I believe it's far too simplistic to say that nuclear weapons alone have prevented major war, the evidence is compelling that they fundamentally changed the notion of warfare between major nations in August of 1945, and their deterrent effect has constrained the scope and scale of conflict ever since. Look, I get the fact that the Cold War is over, okay? And by the way, I got to digress here a little bit. There's actually very few of us in the military left that even served in the Cold War. In my last job, I had a pair of Navy captains that retired with 29 and 30 years of service. Proud naval officers. But when they left, the next junior captain I had, or actually the most senior one, had never served during the Cold War. There's very few of us left that have any idea of what that was like. So that is well behind us in the rearview mirror. But remember, the weapons didn't go away, right? There are a number of nations that still possess those weapons. And I'll tell you that I cannot recommend a defense strategy for this nation that involves counting on the goodwill of other nations, right? We defend against capabilities, not intent. And that's part of what motivates me and most of the people, or all the people over at STRATCOM, when we go to work in the morning. There are still nations out there that seek nuclear weapons as a tool of coercion. Russia may be the only nation on Earth that could destroy us today with their nuclear arsenal, but China's expanding and modernizing. Russia's expanding and modernizing. You don't have to go back but about 2 days to watch what North Korea was doing in terms of their development of ballistic missile technologies, and I can just keep going and going and going. Our adversaries expand, modernize, and test in order to coerce. The coercion is the power of the nuclear weapon system. That is why we take strategic deterrence and assurance so seriously. Look, strategic deterrence is the most important, least glamorous mission in the entire military, okay? Right now in Kings Bay, Georgia, my old home, there's a submariner getting ready to deploy undersea for 77 days, okay? If he has a wife, he's probably not going to talk to her for 77 days. If he doesn't have a wife, he's probably not going to get one anytime soon, right? You are really isolated, okay? And he or she, by the way, because we have women on submarines, is going to work very hard and come back in 77 days, and Kings Bay, Georgia is going to look exactly like it did when he or she left, okay? That's what deterrence looks like, okay? So there's submariners out there. There's men and women in missile silos. There's men and women flying around in aircraft, many of whom leaving off at Air Force Base to accomplish those missions, right? All of them serving in this area such that we can all sit here today and not have to think about it one iota, right? So not glamorous, right, but incredibly important. And it gives us a level of security, frankly, that we have come to take for granted inside this nation. There are 184,000 people involved in the STRATCOM enterprise. The soldiers, sailors, airmen, Marines, and civilians manning our strategic weapon systems are on alert 24/7, 365, standing guard from underwater to outer space. That's what strategic deterrence looks like. I'm very proud of their work as they do this across the globe. What I like about Bellevue is that y'all get this, right? That y'all understand what's going on behind those gates and you support it so very well. Your understanding of and engagement with base operations and your hospitality towards our workforce is just exceptional. We're a better command because of the support and stability of the community of Bellevue. And I'll tell you, with a new headquarters that's 80 to 90% complete, we're certainly not going anywhere anytime soon. So on behalf of General Hyten, myself, our Chief of Staff, I can't thank you enough for that support. I appreciate you having me today, and I'd be happy to take a few questions if anyone was interested.
Anybody got any questions? This is about the quietest I've ever seen this group. So you did a fantastic job, Vice Admiral. I'd like to, on behalf of our Board of Directors and the Bellevue Chamber of Commerce, have a small token of our appreciation. We want to thank you for coming out and spending your afternoon with us. It's very appreciative and absolutely good information. We've got to work on the you all, since we're going to get you grounded here, but we'll get you a snow shovel next year. How's that?
Thank you very much. Very thoughtful.
Again, thank you, Vice Admiral Richard. We're fortunate to have you in our community, and we want to recognize the sacrifice that you make to serve our country, and we're very thankful for your service. And just as you mentioned, as I think back, my dad was stationed in Florida during the Cuban Missile Crisis, so it brings back the tuck and roll. It was a very, very kind of dramatic time as a, I think I was a kindergartner or first grade at the time, but you're absolutely right about most people don't recognize the threats that are out there. They haven't lived that now. So again, on behalf of the Bellevue community, we appreciate your service. I'd like to also state that once again, thank our sponsors that are listening to our programs and on our tables. And again, without a strong, vibrant business community supporting the Bellevue Chamber of Commerce, we wouldn't be able to host an event such as this today. So if I give our sponsors another round of applause, I'd really appreciate it. The goal of the Bellevue Chamber Military Affairs Committee is to foster a pro-business climate to the area through proactive government and military affairs initiatives. And it's to maintain and enhance the business community's relationship with Offutt Air Force Base, tenant units, Air National Guard, and Armed Force Reserve units, and to protect and grow and other Department of Defense operations here in the Heartland region. So it's always good to hear from the Vice Admiral that they recognize, too, the partnership that we have as a community, too. So the Greater Bellevue Chamber of Commerce also focuses on the needs of the Bellevue Offutt community, and your phenomenal support keeps our community moving forward, onward and upward. And I want to thank you for the confidence in the Bellevue Chamber. We'll continue to focus on issues that matter to the Bellevue Offutt community and Eastern Sarpy County. So with that, I want to thank everybody for attending. As they say in the military, you're dismissed. But thank you again for coming out, everybody. So.